The Imitation Game, starring Benedict Cumberbatch, follows the life of Alan Turing, an English-born mathematician who was a key player in cracking the Enigma, the machine used to encode almost all of Germany's World War II transmissions. While the bulk of the film focuses on Alan and his achievement of the Enigma, the story also travels back and forth in time to shed light on Alan's days at Sherborne Public School, as well as the details regarding his arrest in 1951. For this reason, this video is going to be divided into three parts, starting with a critique of the film's depiction of young Alan, then talking about his work with the Enigma, and finally ending with the details regarding his arrest in 1951. I also want to take this chance to say that part 3 of this review is going to center on some pretty dark topics, such as the persecution of homosexuals under British law, death, and suicide. So please bear that in mind before you decide to continue watching. Before I get started, I thought it might be a good idea to talk about the Enigma and how it functions. My reason for doing this is because many of my explanations regarding what this movie gets wrong involve technical jargon about the Enigma and how it operates. The Enigma was invented by a man named Arthur Scurbius, who initially intended to sell it to businessmen with the understanding that they could use the machine to encipher their communications, thus keeping them safe from the prying eyes of rival businessmen. This didn't really work out, however, and the Enigma was eventually adopted by the German government, who adapted it for military use. To use an Enigma, the operator would first select and attach 3 of the 8 available rotors, each one with a different internal wiring, and then adjust the rings around the rotors in conjunction with the rotor's specific wiring. I should also mention that each of these rings was decorated with the letters of the alphabet from A to Z. Then at the bottom of the machine, in an area decorated with holes labeled with the letters of the alphabet, they would then use a series of two-headed cables to link up different letter pairs, like A and Q. This was called steckering. After this was all done, the operator would then move the rotors to correspond with one of 3 randomly selected letters, referred to as a key, which would then appear on the window at the top of the machine. The operator could then type in a message, and if the letter they typed was steckered, it would be transformed into its opposite letter pair, meaning A would become Q. Then the rotors would run, each one transforming the letter into yet another letter, before the light bulb at the top of the machine would light up, showing the new enciphered letter. The reason that the Enigma was so difficult to crack was that all these procedures were changed daily, meaning that every day there'd be new rotors, new rotary ring settings, a new keyword, and worst of all, new cable pairings for them to figure out, before they could decrypt and read the transmissions. The Imitation Game is another subject that the film brings up, but doesn't explain, at least not very well. The Imitation Game was developed by Alan Turing to test the abilities of the thinking machine that he and his colleagues were developing at Manchester University. Round 1 of the game is played with 3 people, an interrogator, a man labeled A, and a woman labeled B. It's the job of the interrogator to figure out which person, A or B, is a man and which is a woman. A fairly difficult task considering that all 3 people are confined to separate rooms and can only communicate by passing notes. Though the interrogator has nothing physical or verbal to base their claims on, they can ask either subject as many questions as they want. For their part, person A will be told to do everything in their power to trip up the interrogator, often by giving vague or confusing answers, while person B will do everything in their power to help the interrogator make the right decision. In round 2 of the game, person A, the man, is replaced by a machine, and the aim of this round is to compare the performance of the machine to that of the man in round 1. Will the machine be able to fool the interrogator for as long as the man did, or will it be found out right away? If the machine was able to deceive the interrogator, then according to Alan Turing, this means that it is capable of thought, as he believed that imitation would not be possible without the ability to think. Now that all that background is out of the way, let's move on to the review. Just like in the film, Alan Turing attended Sherborne School, an old boys' public school located just outside the town of Sherborne in Dorset, England. Despite his gift for math and science, Alan's first years at Sherborne were not easy, as he had a tendency toward independent thought that rubbed some of his teachers the wrong way. Alan also had a difficult time writing and organizing his thoughts on paper, a fact which was frequently commented on by his teachers. Alan's interest in science also led him to perform his own chemistry experiments, which stunk up the dorm rooms, making him very unpopular with other students. Because of this, Alan's first few years at Sherborne were marred with bullying, including one incident during his first year in 1926, where he was trapped underneath some loose floorboards by his classmates, an incident which is depicted in the film. Unsurprisingly, Alan had a difficult time making friends during his first 2 years at school, and it wasn't until his third year in 1928 that he met his first real friend, a boy by the name of Christopher Morcombe. This disparity in dates, of course, means that Christopher was more than likely not the person who helped Alan out from underneath the floorboards, like in the film. Though the movie's depiction of their relationship and Alan's infatuation with Christopher has a solid basis in reality. While movie Alan literally spells out his love for Christopher in a coded love note, the real-life Alan Turing was a bit more discreet, choosing to express his feelings in the form of unwavering dedication and admiration. Analysis of Alan's letters and correspondence regarding Christopher reveal that, if not deeply infatuated, Alan held Christopher in the highest regard, even stating that he worshipped the ground that he walked on. Unfortunately, in the film, just as in real life, the boy's friendship was tragically cut short when, in 1930, Christopher was killed due to complications regarding bovine tuberculosis, an ailment which he had been suffering from for many years. The death of Christopher Morcombe left a great impact on Alan Turing's life. While he never named a computer after him, he did apparently attend seances to try to connect with Christopher's spirit long after his death. Alan Turing reported to Bletchley Park on September 4th, 1939. Prior to this, he'd been recruited to take part in a course on cryptography and encipherment sponsored by the Government Code and Cipher School in London. The film's version of events, however, involve a nearly botched job interview where Alan is berated for his inability to speak German, as well as insisting that his crossword-solving skills could be used to aid the war effort. The head of Bletchley is only persuaded to hire Alan after he claims that he can solve the enigma, stating that it's just a larger, more complex game. Yes, clearly his brilliant idea to compare the enigma to a crossword puzzle is a much more compelling reason to hire him than, say, his extensive background in mathematics and cryptography. It's not like the British government at this time was scrambling to hire anyone with a background in mathematics, cryptography, or linguistics to help them solve the enigma. What they really wanted were people who were good at crosswords. But despite the idiocy of the interview, Alan, along with a few other gaming enthusiasts, are hired to help crack the enigma. But Alan decides that trying to solve the enigma by hand will take far too long, and thus designs a machine to do it instead. Okay, if I'm being completely honest, there are a few things wrong with this section. First, to think that Alan Turing designed and built the British bomb, or Christopher as it's known in the film, all on his own is ridiculous. The higher-ups at Bletchley knew that they couldn't hope to solve the enigma by hand. That's why they assigned Alan and another cryptographer named Gordon Welchman to design a machine that would run through multiple rotor settings to find the enigma's daily key and steckering pairs. The original machine that they based their design on was called a bomb, and it was designed by a group of Polish scientists who worked tirelessly for over half a decade to decipher the enigma before Poland was invaded in 1939. And yet the tireless efforts of all these scientists is condensed down to one line in the film. "I based it on the design of an old Polish machine." Really? The Polish research was top secret. But movie Alan acts like he just went down and looked up the blueprints at the local library. Also, it should go without saying that Alan did not construct the bomb by hand as he does in the film, but instead, the first of many bombs was constructed by the British Tabulating Machinery Factory in Letchworth. Alan Turing was a mathematician, not an engineer. I mean, it's true that the real Alan Turing had an interest in machines and how they were built, but that definitely didn't mean they had the know-how to build a machine as complicated as a bomb on his own. If this wasn't absurd enough, Alan's boss, Hugh Alexander, who I should mention is based on the real Hugh Alexander, a man who worked alongside Turing at Bletchley, decides that he doesn't want a machine that will make their work easier and save thousands of lives, and thus refuses to give Alan the funds needed to build his machine. But Alan decides that he's not going to take that lying down, and writes a letter to Winston Churchill. As a result, Alan is put in charge of Hut 8, the group responsible for solving and dealing with the naval enigma. While it's true that a letter was sent to Winston Churchill from Bletchley Park in 1941, the purpose of the letter was mainly to request more staff to help run Bletchley's day-to-day operations. The letter was also not written by Alan alone, as it was signed and approved by supervisors from Hut 6 and 8, with Alan's name being just one of four signatures. When it comes to Alan's position as leader of Hut 8, it's made quite clear that he held some position of authority from the very beginning. However, when it came time to formally declare the head of Hut 8 in 1942, he was beat out for the position by Hugh Alexander. Though I don't think he's quite that broken up. After he's put in charge, Movie Alan decides to dump some of the department's dead weight and fires two cryptographers. This decision then forces Alan and his team to find new recruits. And Alan suggests that they publish a crossword puzzle in the newspaper with a message for all who solve it to come down for further testing. To everyone's surprise, including probably most of the people in the audience, Alan's crossword idea actually works, yielding two new recruits, including the team's only female member, Joan Clark. Just like in the film, Joan Clark was a brilliant mathematician with a double first degree in mathematics from Newham College in Cambridge. But that's about the only thing that the film got right. In reality, Joan was brought into the Enigma project by one of Alan's colleagues, Gordon Welchman. There was no crossword puzzle or elaborate testing scenario. Bletchley was in need of a mathematician, Joan happened to be one, and that was it. In the film, however, the idea that a woman can actually understand and perform complex mathematics is presented as almost mind-boggling. Before Joan even gets in the door, she's blocked by a man who, under the impression that she's there to interview for a secretary position, refuses to let her in. Even after he's shown the completed crossword puzzle, the man still refuses her entry on the grounds that she must have cheated, because if there's anything that women can't do, it's solve a crossword puzzle. Okay, keeping this scene in mind, the movie has a bit of a problem, not just with Joan's character, but with Alan's as well, as the film seems to go out of its way to victimize both characters. Film Alan is an extremely antisocial loner who refuses to work with others because the world just doesn't understand him. But the real Alan Turing, despite the hardship he experienced in early life, was reasonably agreeable, and got along with most of his colleagues, including Hugh Alexander, who he used to play chess with in his spare time. And Joan Clark was by no means the only female linguist employed at Bletchley. As anyone who studied this period in history can probably tell you, because most of the male population was sent overseas, women were called on to help fill in for men in the workforce, including in fields that required an intimate knowledge of math and science. While it's true that at this time, women in the field of math and science were few and far between, they still existed. Going back to the film, in addition to the sexist treatment that she received during the exam, Joan must also overcome the rather backward beliefs of her parents, who are not overly enthusiastic about the idea of their daughter working in an all-male environment. But, desperate to have Joan for his team, Alan, to help ease her parents' concerns, arranges for Joan to work in Hut 3 with the other female employees. This represents another deviation from reality, however, as the real Joan Clark was employed as a member of Hut 8 from the very beginning. With everything now said and done, Movie Alan and his team set to work building his machine. And when I say the rest of the team, I mean pretty much just Alan, because despite the fact that he's in charge and has ordered them to help construct the machine, the rest of the team still decides to ignore him and go back to using hand methods. Apparently, the mass amount of people fighting and dying overseas isn't motivation enough for them to start working together. Seriously, these characters are assholes. As his colleagues aren't interested in helping him, Alan starts reaching out to Joan, even sneaking into her room at night so they can work on problems together. Again, it'd be a lot easier if she just worked in Hut 8, she could even lie to her parents about it, I mean, she already has to lie to them about her job since everything is classified. Man, this movie is stupid. But Joan eventually convinces Alan that he can't do everything on his own, and at her behest, he starts interacting with the other cryptographers, who come around to help him construct the machine. I suppose friendship was a more compelling reason to get to work than untold destruction and the loss of life. Unless I'm wrong and friendship really is magic. Unfortunately, even after it's finally finished, the machine doesn't seem to work, as rather than give them an answer, it just keeps running indefinitely, giving the head of Bletchley the excuse he needs to pull the plug. However, convinced that the machine could still work, Alan's team persuades the director to give them one more month to try to come up with some results before canning the project. Okay, to be fair, in its early days, Bletchley Park and the practice of cryptology did come under its fair share of scrutiny. But this is because some people believe that the manpower and resources allocated to Bletchley could be put to better use somewhere else. This may sound strange, but keep in mind that World War II was the first war where information was derived primarily from enemy transmissions, as opposed to spies or soldiers, meaning that not only was there much more information to work with, but it was also much more accurate. While this was technically a good thing, because a war had never been fought like this before, the people in charge didn't exactly know how much manpower to assign to the task, meaning that code-breaking operations like Bletchley were often understaffed. There were also those who really did believe that the Enigma was uncrackable, and didn't see the sense in assigning so much time and resources to try to crack it. But while the ignorance regarding Bletchley Park in the 1940s was understandable, the film's reasoning as to why the director wanted to shut off the machine, i.e. that it didn't work right away, is just stupid, especially when you think about all the time and money that went into the project. If his failure with Christopher wasn't bad enough, Alan then finds out that Joan, at the behest of her parents, has decided to go home so she can find a man and get married. Because who cares about the important work she's doing for the war effort? The important thing is that her parents are happy. While I will admit that I don't know a lot about the real Joan Clark, I still don't think she was quite as spineless as her film counterpart. But in an effort to keep Joan at Bletchley, Alan decides to propose marriage, an offer which Joan gladly accepts. Parental involvement aside, this is probably one of the more historically accurate parts of the movie, as Alan Turing and Joan Clark were briefly engaged in 1941. While working together in Hut 8, Alan and Joan had grown reasonably close, and after spending some personal time together, Alan decided to propose marriage. The fact that marriage to a woman didn't correspond with his sexual desires probably wasn't that big of a factor in the 1940s, as at this time, sexual satisfaction wasn't really believed to be all that important when it came to marriage. Instead, marriage was seen more as a social obligation, something that people were expected to do rather than a relationship based on physical or in some cases even emotional attraction. But upcoming nuptials aside, Turing and the rest of his team have only 1 month to get Christopher up and running, and no matter what they do, the machine just can't run fast enough to meet their demands. But while drinking with Joan and the rest of the Hut 8 team, Alan is hit with the idea to program the machine to look for words that they already know will be in the transmission, like those used in the Germans' daily weather report. His idea works, and the team is able to figure out the location of all the enemy shipping. Unfortunately, Alan and the other members of the team realize that acting on the information right away would be a sure sign that the Enigma had been broken, thus rendering all their hard work meaningless. With this new revelation firmly in hand, Alan and Joan then approach MI6 to propose the creation of a special task force called Ultra that will filter all the data and determine what they should act on. There is a lot to digest in this section, but first let me say that multiple factors went into cracking the Enigma, one of which was the use of cribs or word phrases that were almost always included as part of the transmission, like Hail Hitler or Weather Report. The frequent repetition of these words helped to establish a pattern that the cryptographers could use to figure out the daily key. Other key weaknesses of the Enigma system included the fact that no letter could ever be enciphered as itself, which basically meant that no matter how many times you pressed the A button, you would never get another A. And the use of indicators, random strings of words used to test the machines. An indicator was a group of three letters that the operator would choose at random. They would then type them twice and encode them using the Enigma. The receiver of the message would then decode the message using their machine, and if they got the same group of three letters repeated twice, it proved that it was functioning properly. However, while the letters were supposed to be random, the operators would often be a little bit lazy, deciding to instead use three corresponding letters on the keyboard or just repeat the same letter three times. Based on this information, the codebreakers would then develop criteria for how to program the bombs, which would then work out the day's key setting and stickering pairs by discounting all the incorrect combinations. For simplicity's sake, let's stop the explanation there, otherwise I have to go into the details regarding how the bombs operated, and that might get a bit confusing. As for the super secret code-breaking operation, Ultra was a code name used to refer to Bletchley starting sometime in 1941. And as the years went on, the nature of the code-breaking operation became larger and more secretive. Even high-ups within the British government didn't know about Bletchley, believing that most of the information they received came from an MI6 spy network led by a mysterious figure with a code name Boniface. Another factor that contributed towards the Allies' success was the fact that the Germans believed that the Enigma was 100% unbreakable. So even though they suspected that the enemy knew the location of their U-boats, they decided that it was probably the work of an Allied spy ring, rather than believe that the Enigma had been compromised. When it comes to the question of Alan Turing's position within Ultra, I can find no evidence that he led the organization like in the film. Even the book that this film is supposed to be based on, Alan Turing, The Enigma by Andrew Hodges, gives no mention of this fact, so it's a pretty safe bet that this was something that the filmmakers made up. Moving on with the film, one day Alan discovers that one of his co-workers is actually a Russian spy. But upon being confronted, he tells Alan that if he doesn't keep quiet, then he will reveal the truth about him being a homosexual. Though honestly, now that I think about it, this is kind of an idle threat since he doesn't actually have any proof that Alan is gay. I mean, if he does report him for being a homosexual, what are the authorities going to do? Ask him if he's gay, and if he says no, let him go? But the threat seems to work, as Alan decides not to report what he knows to the authorities. But upon arriving back home, he discovers that an MI6 operative is waiting for him. The agent informs him that he already knows about the Russian spy in his midst, and tells Alan that he wants him to spy on the spy so they can find out more about the Russians. Okay, to be honest, if I was going to pick someone to be a spy, the slightly nervous and socially awkward Alan Turing would not be my first choice. But then again, I'm not a secret agent or a screenwriter. Yeah, as far as I can tell, this part is completely fabricated. I think that the writer just overloaded on Red Bull at one point and decided that he needed to do something to spice up the story. All the stress ends up getting the better of Alan, however, and he decides to break things off with Joan by telling her that he's a homosexual. Surprisingly, however, Joan doesn't seem to care about this and still insists that they get married anyway. Alan refuses, however, and the pair get into a heated argument, which actually does result in them breaking up. While it is true that Alan Turing called off his engagement to Joan Clark in 1941, the reason probably having something to do with the fact that he was gay, in real life, the affair went a bit more eloquently. Rather than arguing and getting upset, Alan broke up with Joan by reading her part of an Oscar Wilde poem called The Ballad of Reading Gal. Yet each man kills the thing he loves. By each let this be heard. Some do it with a bitter look, some with a flattering word. The coward does it with a kiss, the brave man with a sword. He also told Joan that he was a homosexual a few days after their engagement, rather than keeping it a secret like he does in the film. Though just like her film counterpart, the real Joan Clark wasn't at all taken aback by this, and told him that they should continue with the engagement anyway. And considering that Joan's father was a clergyman, I think that this is a pretty progressive stance to have in England during the 1940s. After this, the movie flashes forward to the end of the war and details the disbanding of Alan's team and the destruction of Bletchley Park. The Imitation Game comic, which came out just 2 years after the film in 2016, gives a more in-depth look at the destruction of Bletchley Park after 1945. In addition to the destruction of all the documentation, every machine that had been constructed to help break the Enigma, bombs included, was either destroyed or removed. But if you want to go and see Bletchley Park for yourself, then you're in luck, as the site was converted into a museum back in 1993. All the information that the British government tried to keep quiet is now in full display, including first-hand accounts from people that worked at the park, and a replica bomb machine. Flashing forward to 1951 in the city of Manchester, Alan Turing, now visiting professor at Manchester University, finds himself the victim of a break-in but tells the local police not to investigate as nothing has been stolen. One cop finds Alan's explanation suspicious, however, and decides to keep investigating only to find out that his war records have been redacted. Now convinced that he's actually a Russian spy, because there could be no other reason why his records were redacted, the police officer and his colleagues decide to dig deeper, only to discover the true story behind the break-in. It seems that the man who committed the break-in, 19-year-old Arnold Murray, had at one time been Alan's lover, but had decided to start helping himself to some of the things around Alan's home. Then, after speaking to his friend, Harold Thacker, about Turing, Thacker decided to go whole hog and rob Alan's house while he was away. But it would seem that the would-be robber was not quite up to the task, as he made a bit too much noise, alerting the neighbors, who then called the police. While the real Alan Turing, just like his film counterpart, lied to the police to protect himself, and possibly also Arnold Murray, from persecution, an important distinction from the film is that Alan Turing reported the robbery to the police himself. His main motive for doing this seems to be that one of the items that was taken was a watch passed down to him by his deceased father. The film, also rather than focusing on Turing's trial, as many versions of his story have done, instead depicts an interrogation scene where the aforementioned cop finally gets Turing to reveal exactly what he did during the war. This scene, though I can't speak to its historical accuracy, is actually kind of brilliant, as it works to relate the idea of thinking machines with that of homosexuality. Back in the 1950s, the electronic brain that Turing and his colleagues were constructing at Manchester not only made headlines, but also generated quite a bit of controversy, mostly from religious individuals who held that it was impossible for machines to think as they had no souls. Alan Turing, in response to these accusations, would often remark that these criticisms were the result of ignorance regarding the thinking process, which was still very much a mystery. How can you say that machines are incapable of thought when you don't understand what thinking really is or how the brain works? Similarly, while it's no secret that homosexuals, non-like thinking machines, have been and still are persecuted by religious institutions, there is actually another comparison we can draw here. Just as it is misguided to say machines can't think without understanding exactly what thinking is or how it's accomplished, it's equally misguided to deny someone's feelings of attraction because you don't feel the same way. You can deny that machines think because you yourself are not a thinking machine, just as you can deny the existence of same-sex attraction because you yourself are not homosexual. Seriously, there are people today that still believe that homosexuality is a choice rather than something you're born with. Can you imagine what it was like in the 1950s? After he finishes regaling the cop with his war stories, Alan then asks him to pass judgment, asking if he thinks he's a villain or a hero. But the cop feels he isn't able to judge him. However, based on the cop's reaction, we can deduce that he probably does feel sorry for Alan, and why wouldn't he? I mean, the guy helped to save the world, only to be arrested, punished, and have his name dragged through the mud. And worse is that the cop knows he doesn't have the power to change any of that. In 1951, homosexuality, or what was referred to in legal circles as gross indecency, was illegal under British law, and remained that way until 1967. A full 15 years after the case of Regina versus Turing and Murray made it to the courtroom in March of 1952. Flashing forward about a year, we see that as a result of the therapy that he's been forced to undertake, i.e. regular injections of estrogen intended to inhibit his attraction to members of the same sex, Alan Turing has now become a shadow of his former self, preferring to stay inside with only his machine for company. The drugs that he's forced to take make it difficult for him to do even the simple things he once enjoyed, like filling out a crossword puzzle with Joan, demonstrating not only the negative effects of the drugs, but also the barriers he now faces as an out homosexual. In reality, Alan Turing's hormone treatment had a much different physical effect, as he developed gynecomastia, or swelling of his breast tissue, and also began to put on weight. While this was incredibly embarrassing for Turing, he continued his career working at Manchester University. Though at the time he expressed concerns that his ideas, especially those regarding thinking machines, would be ignored as a result of his homosexuality. One clear example of this appears in a letter that Turing wrote to his friend, Norman Routledge, which included a small poem that read, "Turing believes machines think. Turing lies with men. Therefore machines do not think. Yours in distress, Alan Turing." As stated in the film, on June 7th, 1954, Alan Turing committed suicide. His death robbed humanity of one of the world's most gifted mathematical minds, and as David Lovett says in his book, The Man Who Knew Too Much, I am sure that most of us would have preferred a few more years of Alan Turing and his brilliance. But though he may have left the world too soon, his work, particularly his ideas regarding universal machines, lives on in the silicon microprocessors employed by our computers, as well as in the field of microprogramming. Thank you all for tuning into this somewhat depressing episode of Movie vs. History. If you want to find out more about the life and work of Alan Turing, then please check out any of the books listed in the credits. But until next time, this is Silver Jade saying please remember to support your local library, and I'll be seeing you.